When you're in charge of a production database, many tasks are repetitive, and a large part of the job consists in automating these tasks and scheduling them. Oracle comes with its own scheduler, which you manage with procedures contained in a package called Dbms Scheduler. It is associated with many dictionary views that you can list by looking in the dictionary view for everything that is named DBA underscore sched something. I am going to show you how to simply use the Oracle scheduler, but you may want to read more. Like everything Oracle, it has lots of features and can be complicated. With Dbms Scheduler, you associate a program to run with a time frequency, and the association is called a job. I won't talk about it, but instead of a time frequency, you can trigger program execution on events, such as the apparition of a file in a directory, or dependencies, which means running a program after another one that has succeeded, or perhaps failed. Why use the Oracle scheduler rather than the operating system scheduler? If you are administering Oracle both on Linux and Windows systems, it will be more consistent. But more importantly, if the database is down for any reason, an externally scheduled database task will fail and may be skipped depending on how it was coded. With the internal scheduler, it will run when possible. You can take an action and create a program by assigning it a name. You can take a time and a frequency and create a schedule by assigning it a name. And you can use the name program and the name schedule to create a job. Or you can directly associate an action to a job, or time and a frequency, in any combination. As usual, it's a matter of reusability and flexibility. If you refer to something that is used at multiple places by an alias, which is exactly what are both a defined program and a defined schedule, you can change them more easily. For DBA tasks, usually the programs are uncalled from many places, but you may have to shift when they are run. This is why I directly associate actions to jobs, but I shall create schedules. When you install Oracle Express, it comes with some pre-scheduled tasks. You can find them by checking view DBA Scheduler Job Log, which records jobs that have actually run. There are two jobs. Gather stats job collects information such as the number of rows in tables or the selectivity of indexes that is used by the query optimizer to determine how best to run a query. Purge log actually purges the very same table we have been querying. Job class isn't something I'll talk about. It's mostly a way to assign a lower priority to maintenance tasks that run in the background. But the main view to query is actually DBA Scheduler Jobs, where you can find the program name and the schedule name, if both a program and a schedule were defined. I have added a condition on state to my query, because you'll notice that there are some other inactive jobs that are defined. They are related to Enterprise Edition options. You find schedules in DBA Scheduler Schedules, and you see here that daily purge schedule is an alias for firing something every day at 3 a.m., just like having an alarm clock. But it brings an interesting question, because if you remember the query on DBA Scheduler Jobs, the schedule name for Gather Stats Job was given as Maintenance Windows Group. There is no such thing in the view that lists schedules. Windows and Windows Groups are a different notion. You notice the Windows group that incites us to query the view called DBA Scheduler WinGroup Members. The group is composed of two windows, Weeknight Window and Weekend Window. The gory detail is to be found in DBA Scheduler Windows. Weeknight Window starts at 10 p.m. from Monday to Friday, and it extends for 8 hours. Weekend Window starts at midnight on Friday, and it lasts 2 days. So, to try to visualize everything, the weeknight window starts every evening of the week and extends into the following morning until 6 a.m. The weekend window covers Saturday and Sunday, and we mustn't forget that we have daily purge schedule, which is an alarm at 3 a.m. every morning. At the start of every defined window, the scheduler looks for tasks to run in that window and dynamically creates a temporary schedule. Like with the job classes, you can also play on priorities with windows, which are designed for long-running tasks. Now, let's check the action associated with program purge log prog. It's a procedure from the DBMS scheduler package. but if you take a look at the package documentation, you won't find it. Auto purge is undocumented. However, if you check the documentation for the purge procedure, you'll find some information. Navigating the Oracle documentation is an important DBA skill. Unless you want to click on the Backup Database option in the menu every evening before going back home, you'll probably want to schedule backups, and that's what I'm going to show you now. There are some differences between Linux and Windows. Let's start with Linux. The first thing to do is to connect as Oracle and create a directory for your own script somewhere. Then, copy the provided backup script to this directory because you need to modify it. The first change required is to define home that is only used as the location of the log file. If the scheduler runs the script, the environment variable would not be set, so you must set it to location that is writable by user Oracle. The second change is that you must remove anything that asks for user interaction. There are a number of read commands in the script. When something such as Y or N is expected, decide on whatever looks reasonable to you, but nobody will be there to answer any question. Once you have modified the script, connect as user system. It's important because as sys you cannot run an external program. I am going to create first a schedule by calling procedure create schedule, first giving a name to the schedule, then specifying the first time when it fires, trunk applied to sysdate plus 1 gives me midnight today, and if I add 1/6 of a day it will be 4 a.m, and I will repeat it every day at 4 a.m. For testing purposes you may want to set something else. Then I could create job, assign a name to the job, and associate it to the schedule I have just created, say that the type is executable, which means that it is an external program as opposed to a stored procedure, and give as job action the full path to the modified backup script. One thing that is important is that you must say that enabled is true, otherwise the job will be created but not activated. And you're done. If you're impatient to see what it gives, you can run the job immediately by calling the run job procedure. You can check that everything is ready by querying DBA Scheduler Jobs, checking when all scheduled jobs are expected to run next. If you are running this in a SQL Plus console, you may want to limit the width of the time column. Tomorrow morning, or now if you have just run the job, you can check that it went smoothly by checking DBA Scheduler Job Log, and I'm going to limit to what happened today. Some formatting will make it look better if you are running the query under SQL Plus. If the status shows failure, you need to query DBA Scheduler Job Run Details. Error messages appear in column Additional Info, and I am going to rank messages most recent one first for read job or subjob. I wrap my query in another query so as to only display the most recent failure message. As you can see, good SQL skills are also helpful when you are a DBA. Now for Windows. The first and very important step is to start the service Oracle Job Scheduler XE, which isn't started by default. Without it, nothing will work. Then it's like with Linux. You should copy the backup script, backup.bat, that is under bin, to a different directory because you also need to modify it. Look for the set/p and post commands and remove them, assuming whichever you think appropriate when you're supposed to provide an answer. You need to understand the script to modify it safely. Then I'm going to do something a bit different from before. I have told you that when you take a backup, you should save it elsewhere in case the server fails. I'm going to write a very simple PowerShell script that first runs the backup script, then gets and formats the date, then zips everything that was created today and writes it to drive G, which I assume to be a network drive. Once again, backup.bat here is the suitably modified script, which needs no user interaction. Then I save my script as backup-and-save.ps1. Once again, I am going to schedule the backup as user system. When I create the schedule, it's exactly the same statement as I used under Linux, as it is pure Oracle syntax. The difference is when I create the job, because what I actually run isn't backup-and-save.ps1, but PowerShell that is given the script as argument. It would be similar with the .bat script, except that in that case I would need to invoke cmd.exe. I cannot say that the action is a program with its list of arguments. I must specify separately program and arguments. What I need to say is that my program will take one argument, and I must also set enable to false because I cannot enable a job as long as all of the arguments for the action or program are unspecified. Then, I set the argument value by specifying the job name, the position of the argument, and the argument value, in that case, the path to my .ps1 file. Finally, I can enable the job, and I'm done. Everything else works the same as previously. I have said at the end of the third video in this series that it is important to be able to monitor and predict growth trends, and I am going to show you how you can do it. You have seen that Oracle collects statistics every evening by default, and very importantly, it computes, or sometimes estimates, the number of rows in every table, overwriting the previous value. At the same time, by querying dictionary views to check storage allocation, you can get the number of kilobytes, or megabytes if your tables are big, used by a table and its associated indexes. You can save this to a table, and with help from the scheduler, save it regularly. That will tell you how space relates to, say, a number of customers or a number of registered users, will help you monitor past growth and discuss trends with figures that are meaningful for people who know the business, but not Oracle. The first thing you need to do is connect a sys and grant to user system the select privilege on DBA tables, DBA indexes, and DBA segments. I assume for the sake of simplicity that you aren't using large objects or lobs in your tables. I am going to create a stored procedure that queries these views, and even when I'm a DBA, I need the privileges to be granted directly to my account to refer to table of views in a stored procedure, even if I can access these tables and views. Then I'm going to create, as user system, a table to store a date, an owner, a table name, a number of rows, the size of data proper, and the size of indexes. I create this table in tablespace.sysox, since this isn't user data. Next, I write a query that retrieves from DBA tables and DBA segments the identification of a table, its number of rows, and the size of the associated data segment. And I choose to exclude schemas sys and system. You are free to select what you want to include or exclude. This is the first part of the query. In the second part, I get the size information for the indexes that have been created on the table. This will result in one row for each table with its size and number of rows, and one row with each index and its size. Beware that this is a relatively simple query, and if you are using some advanced storage options, it may need some rewrite. Then I'm going to use the previous query, use it in a from clause, and sum up all the sizes so as to have a single row per table. I insert the result of this query into the table I've just created. I wrap the insert statement into procedure, and I am ready to schedule it. This time, I don't create any schedule. I specify everything in the create job call, giving the job type as stored procedure, and scheduling it for every Sunday, starting next Sunday at 6 a.m. No need to check sizes every day. I'm interested by long-term trends. What else? You can monitor performance, once again using the scheduler to regularly collect information. Just watch my two-part video on Oracle Performance Monitoring. It explains how to set it up. This ends this series on Oracle Administration. There are many, many other things to Oracle Administration, but I have presented what I think is really important, and if you have well understood the concepts, with a little practice, the three of you who have watched all the videos in this series will probably become honorable junior DBAs. Read the docs, hone your SQL and scripting skills, experiment, try variations on what I've shown, have fun, and thank you for your attention.